We know that V7 is an amazing tool for annotation and dataset management, but you can use the SDK and API to accomplish so much more. One amazing feature is the Darwin Torch API, with which you can very easily create your beloved PyTorch data loaders from your V7 datasets. Let me quickly show you how simple it is. Okay. Again, as always, the first thing that we need to do when writing a script or coding is importing our dependencies. And we'll look at what each individual module does when getting to that actual point. So let's look at the dataset that we want to use for our data loaders. In this case, we'll be using the bird species dataset that is on the V7 open datasets page. We here have some instance segmentation polygons, and we here have 1,909 labels and 3 classes. Okay, and to actually get that dataset, we'll use the command line interface. There actually is a whole separate video on how to actually export datasets from V7, and I recommend you to watch that. But again, in this case, I'll be using the command line interface, which in my opinion actually is the most comfortable or easiest way of exporting your data. Okay, so now we have downloaded our dataset, and we can actually also look at our dataset in our Darwin's dataset directory here in the team V7 open datasets. We here have the bird species, we here have all of our images, and we here have the releases with all the annotations. Okay, since we have that, we can actually continue and load our datasets into our main memory using the PyTorch or Darwin Torch API. And it's really, really simple. We first need to specify the dataset ID, which consists of the team name or the team slug, again, in this case, V7 open datasets, and then the dataset name, bird species, which we have just looked at in our directory. We then call this one function that is provided by our Darwin Torch API, which is called getDatasets. We here provide our dataset ID to just specify which dataset we actually want to access. And then we also specify the dataset type. We here have instance segmentation labels, so that is what we will provide as an argument. And that's pretty much it. You now have your dataset in main memory or your dataset manager, and we can now actually just access the dataset and look at some statistics, for example. We can here see that our dataset has 1,909 labels. It has 3 classes. In this case, it has the African gray parrot, European robin, and nightingale. We can also look at one image, or the first image in this case, of our dataset, which is this nice little nightingale. And honestly, that's pretty much it. You now have your dataset and can just plug it into your PyTorch data loaders, and that's it. But you can do a bit more with Darwin. And that's why I want to continue this little video and actually look at what it can do. So in machine learning, we all know that it's really common to create different partitions for your data. You want to have a training, validation, and testing split. And you can already directly do that using V7, using the command line interface. And this is what we'll be doing in this cell. So to perform this action, we'll just call Darwin dataset split, provide the dataset that we want to split, and the splitting ratio. In this case, we'll be using 70% of the data for training, for validation we'll be using 10%, and for testing 20%. So let me just run this command, and then we'll look at what Darwin actually does in the background. Okay, that's it. Now let's look what Darwin actually did in the background. So if we go to the releases, go to latest, go to the lists, and then to this specific split that you can also see down right here, we can see that Darwin has created 2 different splits, one random split and one stratified split. In general, stratified is a bit more better performing, so you can just select what you would like, a random split or a training split. Then have those little txt files, which just specify which of the images with the corresponding labels are then associated with the testing split, with the training split, and the validation split, in this case, the random ones. And then we have the stratified polygons for the testing split, for the training split or partition, and for the validation partition. And that's it. We now have our dataset split into training, validation, and testing sets. And now let's actually look at how we can create our datasets using those partitions. We were using the exact same function as we have done right above here with the getDatasets call, but this time we'll be providing a few more arguments. So we again have dataset ID, which just for completeness, I've again written down right here. And then we'll call our getDatasets function. So we'll again provide our dataset ID, we'll provide the dataset type, and then we'll have to specify which partition we want. In this case, this will be the dataset training partition. Then we'll provide the splitting type. We'll use the stratified partition instead of the random partition. And then we can also directly provide a list of different transforms. When training computer vision models on images, it's useful to apply different transformations to your images for your model to generalize better. And in this case, we'll be using the transforms API, which is again provided by the Darwin Torch transforms API. And we'll have a composition of random horizontal flips, and then we'll transform our images directly into tensors. The same applies to our validation dataset, instead that we'll be here selecting the partition validation, and we'll only be applying a two-transform transformation because usually you want to see the performance of your model on the raw images that you provide. Now, since this is done, let's go ahead and just run the cell, and we can again look at some statistics just to verify that everything is going as we expected. If you look at the normal dataset, we again have our original 1,909 images or labels. And if we look at our training dataset, we have 1,338, which is 70%. And then we have 190 images in our validation dataset, which corresponds to our 10% respectively. And that is how you can easily create your dataset splits using Darwin. Now let's go one tiny step further and just look at some actual PyTorch training code for some computer vision models using Torchvision and the actual PyTorch data loaders. I'm sure that you're already very familiar with all the code from here, so let's just go ahead and run through it. So in this cell, we are actually creating the PyTorch data loader, and this is using the standard PyTorch data loader API call, and we here provide the dataset that we've created using the Darwin Torch API, right? And then we again continue with the standard arguments that you would provide using the data loaders, like the batch size, if you want to shuffle your data or not, and so on. So let's just quickly run the cell, create our data loader for our training dataset, and get to the next cell that actually instantiates our model, which in this case will be a mask RCNN model using our Torchvision API. So what we'll just do here is we'll quickly load in a model from our Torchvision API. In this case, we were using the ResNet 50 mask RCNN model that is pre-trained on the COCO dataset. Now, since it is pre-trained, we'll need to replace the actual prediction heads, and we'll do that in this case for our bounding box predictor. We will here replace it with a newly initialized fast RCNN predictor. And then we'll do the same for the mask predictor. We won't go into details about the mask RCNN model itself, but it can predict bounding boxes and segmentation maps. So again, we'll place our bounding box predictor of our model with a freshly initialized fast RCNN predictor, and we'll replace the mask predictor with a freshly initialized mask RCNN predictor. And that is how we'll get our model. So we can now get to the basic optimization setup. First, we'll start with selecting the device that we are using. In my case, I'll be having a CPU. Then we'll actually get our segmentation model by providing the number of classes. In this case, we'll be using the number of classes that we have in our dataset, plus one, because we also want to include one background class. Once we have instantiated our model, we'll then push it to our device and then get to constructing our actual optimizer. This is done by actually extracting the parameters that require gradients that will be trained, that means that are not frozen, and then we'll just select our optimizer. In my case, I'm using Adam, but you can of course use whatever you want or whatever works best for you. For example, stochastic gradient descent or Adam W or whatever. What we'll also be doing here is just selecting a learning rate scheduler, because why not? Let me run the cell, and we can actually go to the training loop. This is again your standard training loop. You have the outer loop, which runs over the epochs. In this case, we have selected 10 epochs. And in the inner loop, we'll be going over the whole dataset using our data loader that has been created using the dataset that was created using the Darwin Torch API. And in here, again, basic stuff. We'll collect our images and push them to our device. We'll get our ground truth labels, push them to the device, and then run everything through our model and compute the loss. We then, of course, zero out the gradients of our optimizer and then actually backpropagate the computed loss and then actually update the weights using our optimizer. For model performance tracking, we'll just accumulate the loss, and after 10 iterations, we'll just print out what loss we have received, or the mean loss rather, and then just again reset our accumulated loss. After we're done with one iteration, iterating over one entire dataset, we then step our learning rate scheduler and repeat the same process all over again for the next epoch. And this just shows how easy and fast you can create a dataset and a data loader using Darwin Torch. But what isn't really fast is this training loop in my case. So I'm sorry, but I won't let this training run through, but I think you got the point. And that was it for this video. With V7, you have an amazing interface for creating and managing datasets with different versions. And with the Darwin Torch API, you can easily start your standard PyTorch training using data loaders. It's really the best of both worlds, so that you can focus on training amazing models. I hope this video helped you with getting started with V7.